So yeah, fantastic. So I so let's start. So I guess to begin with, I just wanted to know kind of what area of work you're particularly interested in, and then we'll just build up a few sort of ideas from this.
Yeah. So, hi, my name is Amitabh. I live and work in Bangalore right now. I draw. That's primarily what I do. And as an extension of the practice of drawing, I'm interested in the various ways that it speaks to the world. I make comics. I work in public spaces. And it's, I think, by virtue of working in public spaces that I'm extremely interested in a larger public life of art processes or creative processes. So part of what I do of late has been to initiate festivals. I produce zero budget festivals, which means that we don't need a funder, we don't need a big budget. The template is absolutely replicable and it's completely inclusive. So, I mean, primarily interested in creating ecosystems for other artists such as myself to find a way to sustain what they do. That's pretty much what I'm doing right now. I also teach. I teach in this art design institution called Shishti. And of late, I've been trying to work on a form of practice that allows me to assimilate various diverse ways of approaching art. I use pedagogy as an art tool. I synthesize it with my interest in public spaces and my interest in setting up closed door constellations and I sort of amalgamate all three to create projects. So I'm interested in producing spectacles and projects in the public realm and trying to find a way that they could be in conversation with our larger political reality as well as our primary responsibility to ourselves as artists, which is to sustain ourselves.
Very cool. Yeah, sounds really nice. And then I guess with the type of work you're doing, do you think that it's important for the artist to be highlighting social injustices, social problems, ecological, especially within India itself?
I would see it differently. I think the role of the artist is not just that of a highlighter, in the sense that I'll give you an example. Of late, there's been a lot of conversation in India, especially around sexual violence, which is gender based. It is an offshoot of the Me Too movement, but in the art world, very recently it's taken a very interesting spectre where one of our most prominent artists has been accused of sexual misconduct, continuous sexual misconduct, not a direct sexual offense, but persistent sexual misconduct over time takes the form of sexual offense. And what he did was he put on a 50 million rupee lawsuit on the anonymous accuser, which is an Instagram account that made the accusation. So what it did was that it really made the art world look at itself and look at its own politics. And it was very interesting because there was a bunch of people, and I noticed through a friend of mine who was part of the churning that's happening at large, and she told me that in Delhi, one way that people were trying to approach this was to set up committees, or to set up artist unions that ensure that there is conversation around sexual health and gender transparency within the arts.
Nice.
Now that is a proactive move that immediately impacts the situation on the ground.
Yeah.
Which is one way of looking at the way the arts could operate.
Yeah.
However, there were another group that wants to do an exhibition about it and wants to do a performance about it.
Yeah.
Which, and they're very stark realities, right? So there's one bunch of artists who want to do something that is directly feeding into the cause of concern, that is feeding into the provocation with direct action.
Yeah.
And there's another sort of a group that wants to look at what happened as muse, as inspiration, or as instigation for further art.
Okay.
I don't know if one could take a judgment call on what is right and what is not, but what is very clear is which one is effective.
Yeah.
And I think for me, it's absolutely important, rather than do an exhibition about a social issue, or rather than, you know, you embody the politics. In as much as the politics, in as much as you are the product of prevalent political models, you embody them, and then you manifest the form through your embodiment. So, about caste, about class, about gender, about the current threat to what many consider as our national fabric. It is an interesting time to be an artist in India, because the space to be apolitical is shutting down very rapidly. There is no meaning or there is no relevance in just producing forms. It is more about a formula. It is more about an idea. It is more about, I wouldn't say concept, because this is, I mean, it's not akin to what we understand as conceptual art per se. But I think it's more systemic in the way it manifests itself and is reliant on its existence and the understanding of its existence within a certain system. So my father says, actually, and I'm still debating the merits of what he says, but he says that the state will never have any problem with the arts, because the arts is an easy way for them to create a boiler room for dissent. If there's any political dissent, if there is any critique of the work of the state, just do an exhibition. Within the white room, it will just ricochet off itself. It won't find a way to speak to the world at large. And as long as the white room ensures that there is an implosion of revolutionary ideas or renegade ideas or ideas that are in critique of the dominant state position, the state will always be okay with it. So artists will not be persecuted, first thing, because they don't pose a threat, is his hypothesis. Well, you could ponder over that, I guess.
Yeah, for sure. So then this is almost comparing the white room to almost like a prison for the artist. Is that what you're getting at? I mean, like, they've been assigned that area, and this is, it will just keep repeating them.
Yeah, it's a convenient system for all.
Yeah.
It's a convenient system for all till the economics of it supports all parties interested. The state is very happy with it, because it doesn't come in their way. It doesn't let alternate ideas impede their sense of how things should run. And if the ecosystem supports it, the artist makes money and the gallerist makes money. So it's a very safe space. It's like an island, you know.
Sure thing. And so then this takes us to getting out of the white room and onto the street, which I guess when I'm looking more into political art, activism art, and the practicalities of it, obviously in the white room, somebody just being like, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong, when only ever speaking to the same audience. It's not getting anywhere. So then you personally will take your work onto the street and do your big mural, I understand, over big space on the wall. And so maybe you could say a bit more about, or maybe highlight the importance of taking art out of the gallery and the importance of actual street art, especially within India. You know, how this is impacting, and if it can impact social change.
Well, just in its premise itself, I think I would like to introduce the politics of working in public spaces first through its premise, which is of taking the initiative to doing something, which in itself is a very radical idea, like I was saying earlier, within the contemporary art context. Because if you are coming from an art-trained background, even if you're not coming from an art-trained background and you're reliant on gallery practices to provide you for a platform to showcase your artwork, therein lies the flaw, because you're waiting for somebody else to do something for you, and somebody will invite you, or you, or somebody will show your work, as opposed to understanding, having a larger systemic understanding of your practice and embracing the fact that your first responsibility as a creator is not just to create a potent media form. Your first responsibility as a creator is to find your public.
Yeah.
And I think working in public spaces liberates the artist. And working in public spaces also allows the artist to evolve themselves into seekers of a certain kind of dialogue or seekers of a certain kind of public, as opposed to people who need to be affirmed about their practice, or as opposed to people who need to be celebrated constantly, you know. So that I think is a major shift when once you start working in public spaces.
Yeah.
Also, a lot of there is an argument to be made about the fact that we live in a visually saturated environment, and if you're working in public spaces, you are already entering a saturated space. But if you look at that argument with some nuance, you understand that we are living in a visually, the saturation is of visual communication, which is that a constant need for the image to make meaning of itself, a constant need for the image to directly communicate what the message is, are the images that we surround ourselves with. And Bangalore is actually a good space to talk about this, because about a year or so ago we had bans on hoarding boards, huge plastic flex hoarding boards, giant. We're not allowed to have them anymore.
Fans on them. Like the big billboards.
Huge billboards.
Yeah.
We don't have any billboards within the city.
Yeah, okay.
It was when they were gone that we realized that shit, man, you know, we were living in absolute visual communicable clutter.
Yeah.
What bringing in an artistic project does to that agenda is it ruptures that agenda.
Okay.
I'll tell you a simple story. I was painting in Shahpur Jat in 2014. Now Delhi has these Lal Dora areas, which means they are urban villages, where the municipal laws don't apply in the same way that it applies to elsewhere.
Okay.
So there are no, I mean, there are different laws. I won't go into the details.
Yep.
But it's a very tightly pocketed sort of a borough, essentially. And when I'm painting there, it's also because rent is cheap. Because there is no check on growth or building. So if you have one floor, you can build three floors and not pay extra tax for it, and so on and so forth.
Wow.
A lot of these first and second floors become sweatshops.
Okay.
Textile, printing, woodwork, tapestry, hosiery, garments, so on and so forth.
Yeah.
So I was working in an area like that. And when I was, for some reason, my project there was not make a representative image, but to occupy the space as long as I can.
Okay.
So inhabitation of public space became a performance.
Yeah.
And the image allowed you to perform in public space. This is 2014, like 5 years ago.
Yeah.
So what happened was that now I had solicited the wall myself. Both the terrace that I was painting on top of and the wall that I was painting was a large wall, it was about 60 feet by 40 feet on top of a terrace, so it was like 4-story tall literally at that height. And I was just making lines after lines after lines after lines after lines after lines after lines, after lines, and every time when I came down, there were about 20 people waiting for me down there, impatiently wanting to ask, what the hell am I painting? And I would just joke with them, I would laugh with them.
Yeah.
But very soon they lost their sense of humor, and by the fifth day, the shopkeeper who I would buy my cigarettes from, he got very upset at me. He said that yesterday what you had drawn looked like Lord Ganesha. He's an Indian god, the elephant god. And today it's looking like goat's intestines. What are you trying to prove? What are you trying to talk about? And then finally, on the 10th day, when I went to buy my cigarettes, he just wouldn't talk to me. He wouldn't even give me my cigarettes. I'm like, what's wrong? Why are you so upset? And he erupted. He was like, what is this? I said, it's a soap. What is that? A packet of chips. And what is this? I said, that's a chocolate. They look like soap, chocolate and chips. What is that that you made? What does that look like? And he was very upset.
Yeah.
That he couldn't understand what I've done.
Yeah.
I mean, after some time, I realized that when it highlights the need for the instantly satiable image. And once you don't give the instantly satiable image, you complicate the set relationship that the viewer has with the public image.
Sure.
So that break is something that I think at least I enjoy a lot, apart from the fact that I work on something that I initiate or I'm invested in. But, and here's the third thing, and this is, I think, upon thought, maybe slightly contentious, but, I mean, you've been in India for a while.
It's my fourth time.
Fourth time.
Fourth
so, you keep coming back.
Yeah, I love India.
Excellent.
Yeah, it's a funny country.
You understand the importance of faith in this country?
Faith.
F-A-I-T-H. Faith.
Oh, faith, yeah. Of course. Yeah. So it seems to be, like in Bangalore, I guess it's going down.
Really?
You think?
What makes you think so?
I just thought with, again, this is before, from an outsider's point of view, just as money becomes more godlike, God becomes less godlike.
That's
okay. Like, people will be praying for a new car rather than help their grandma.
That's an idea.
Yeah.
But my sense is that faith is something that we need to relook at, and I think because we are a faith loving people, across the country, probably one of the things that is consistent is our attachment to the idea of faith. So you have faith that there is a God, you have faith that the God shall provide. It is the faith in the other, or faith always being placed outside the individual, that creates a problem. Because you stop taking responsibility for what is around you, because the other will, and you have faith in the other.
Sure.
So the government will do it, the state will do it, the gods will do it, our municipal cooperator will do it, because we have faith in these systems.
Yeah.
We forget that the first relationship with faith is our own relationship with faith in ourselves.
Yeah.
And I guess it also embellishes of these ideas around the age of the individual is over, and now we are entering the age of systems, where the individual is a cog in a wheel.
Yeah.
So what it does when people see the performance of a singular entity painting large pieces in public spaces, is that in some small way, and this is really being optimistic, it reminds you to have faith in yourself. In the performance of a singular artist making the image. And I guess it goes hand in hand with a certain sense of public responsibility, because the nature of at least my practice in public spaces is not to vandalize. I mean, I don't just take a spray can and go anywhere. I speak to the owner.
Sure.
I work with permission. I work in my own time and my own speed, and my practice is based on public consent.
Okay.
So this idea of public consensus, or the creation or using the performance of creating an image to somehow transform public consensus around faith, is another experimental idea that I feel public spaces allow.
Yeah.
So this is how I feel that the politics, it not only responds to politics or highlights politics, but it creates its own paradigm of politics, which is critical.
Yeah, very nice. Yeah. So I guess for you, the act of singularly performing a piece of art on the street is perhaps as important or more important for, like, what you're saying, to have personal faith. One person can do this. Is maybe as important or more important than the actual message that you're painting.
Or the images. The image is something that I'm not relying on to create conversation with the public that I want to be in conversation with. And it is because the image is irrelevant that I can take the same idea of self-initiated proactive action done by the singular person into producing festivals. Or into creating context where others can come and partake on. Because the fact that a singular entity can do this is much more important than a pretty image, or the system is much more important, or the formula is much more important than the form.
Sure,
So because I've been doing this for a while, I feel that as an image maker, ironically, it's very important that I don't take the image seriously.
Yeah, that is ironic.
It is very ironic, but it is a point of clarity.
Yeah,
that for me the image is a thing that is part of the natural process.
Yeah,
there will be an image that it is what the evolution of the process suggests.
Sure thing.
What the image will be is dictated by multitude of factors, many factors.
Yeah.
And I'd rather engage with those factors than obsess over the image.
So
I come from a very classical mode of image making. I'm committed to the image in a manner that I make life decisions based on the fact that I draw.
Yeah.
So it's something that's I've internalized the image in a manner, in a way that I don't care about it anymore.
Sure. Yeah, that's really true. Yeah, very cool. And I guess with this as well, you're kind of cutting through a lot of blockages that might be put there by the social system. So I'm thinking like education as much as anything. I guess the variation of education levels in India is pretty wide. So then I guess your idea of this is a performance about having personal faith that one person can do, make a change, cut through any level of education necessary to understand the piece of artwork?
No, I don't think so at all. No, I mean that. Hopefully one day, but I think right now it's working at the level that it's working in, and I think education is much too complex space within India for it to be even affected by an artistic practice in a manner through the image. I don't think the images that I make in public spaces have any impact on the disaster that we are facing when we look at education in the subcontinental context, because it really worked, and I think it's following a capitalistic model where it's a neoliberal agenda, education right now. I teach for a living, so trust me, I know.
Yeah.
Where it's just a trap to be stuck in a certain form of living. And I'm extremely critical of being trapped.
Yeah, sure.
So I think it's become very important that I be reasonable about it. No, it doesn't have any impact on educating people. I don't think it can educate people. I think at the most they might see it and they might remember it, and the image itself is again it's secondary. Not just secondary, it need not be fetishized.
Yeah.
In the sense, the process is interesting.
Yeah.
But the image that I leave behind is momentary. It's just I'm responding to impulses that are on site, and it is. I think the fact that the image doesn't mean anything, that the image becomes political.
Okay.
If I make a meaningful image, then I'm contradicting my own ideas of how it's politically charged.
So maybe, like I say, I'm just trying to understand myself, maybe the best route to go down as an artist to actually bring about change. You know, and like one thing, again, looking back on like David Attenborough, for example, and he was like, he's a great man, right? And he was like, he was in a conversation about climate change, and he was like, it's so important, it's the biggest thing, it's my biggest love and fear and hate, and it's the most critical thing that we have to face right now. But he's like, the way you can't go about it is by shoveling down people's throats, you know, and just, you know, he's like, I would much rather show the beauty of the world to people and let them make their own minds up about whether they want to keep that world the way it is or if they want to, you know, go in this direction. So I guess this is kind of what you're saying as well, is that you don't want to have this image being like, you know, forcing it down people's throats, your personal political agenda.
I mean, look at it this way. Public spaces are cultural commons, which means that they are owned by everybody. You know, it's an inclusive space in that sense. So one way to look at me drawing in public spaces, we could see it as an act of public transgression, where I'm transgressing a cultural common space, public wall, and you can see so much in a blank wall, and you can see the universe in a blank wall. But when I make it specific to what my ideas are or what my intent is, I limit the possibilities of that space.
Mm-hmm.
I make the possibilities of that space specific. And I think it is an act of violation. You are violating you know, a larger public claim to that space by claiming it as yours.
Yeah.
So that's the way, that's the one way I feel the role of the artist really changes for me. Because the artist in working, like me, I don't see myself as a creator of an image in public space. I initiate the life of an image in public space.
Okay.
And then the image becomes a living thing.
Mm-hmm.
Because anybody can spit on it, spray paint on it, repaint it, remove it, make a shop outside it. I have no control over it.
Sure.
It doesn't. It's not the same precious thing. And that's actually what I've learned the most from working in public spaces, is to let go of the image I make or dissociate myself totally from what I do. Once it's over, once my role in the becoming of that image is over, then the image just is. Without me. And that, I think, becomes absolutely critical. I don't see the same rules of classical art practice being, the rules totally change, the paradigms totally shift. And that's the biggest learning I've had working in public spaces as a graphic artist. It's allowed me to, believe me, as an image maker, I'm only interested in making.
Yeah.
I'm not interested in the image.
Okay.
I'm interested in making the image. So I have to create, you could call it process, but I'm just, my interest is to create scenarios for me that allow me to make.
Yeah.
I'm not interested in making a great artwork.
Yeah.
I'm interested in continuously making artwork.
Okay.
It's selfish thinking that way, but
yeah.
I don't know any other way to think.
Okay, so,
So
it's really interesting. Yeah. It's amazing how people go about their ways.
It is. And that's the beauty of working in public spaces. It has, because you're engaging with a persistent narrative that your image has, to a larger public, which is why you call, why it is public, you know. It really informs and affects you in a way that is most surprising.
Yeah.
And deeply powerful.
Yeah.
Very
nice. Yeah. Super cool.
Thank you so much for this.
No. You're a friend, I have to be honest with you.
Yeah, that's great, that's great. And I don't want to keep you for too long because we've got something to do.
Ask me any question you had planned, irrespective of my answer.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I was... So have you actually worked with political activists or in any of this kind of role of things, maybe as an artist?
Yeah, of course. In fact, my initiation of working in public spaces began with a group of political activists, you can call them, yeah. And we were protesting the Commonwealth Games.
Commonwealth Games, okay.
This is before 2010, I was in Delhi. And I'd done this exhibition of comics that I'd made called Gaya Khagai, which is called The Cow Ate It Up. So imagine if you're talking and you just turn your head there and I just see your pen.
Yeah.
You're like, hey, where's my pen gone? I'm like, Gaya Khagai, The Cow Ate It Up. So the same thing happened to Delhi. Because Delhi was promised this global city, the mega city, because in lieu of the Commonwealth Games, and what essentially was happening was a lot of ad hoc urban transformation that was seemed pretty pointless at that time. So I was working in Sarai, I was working with Iram, and I had done this comic about a cow eating up Delhi.
Yeah.
Literally a giant, the stadium lands like a UFO, giant cow comes out and it eats up Delhi.
Yeah.
So some people saw that comic, that exhibition, and they were very interested in working in public space. This is before I'd even started painting murals very seriously. So we went one night with paint and brush, and they started writing slogans.
Yeah.
And I just sat there and I looked. And I was wondering whether, at that point of time, if it agreed with the aesthetic that I had in mind. Because, again, the image at that point was important. This is more than 10 years ago.
Yeah.
And that was my first foray into working in public spaces with a bunch of political activists writing slogans, anti-state slogans.
Okay.
And it was an acutely disappointing event. Because I realized that there was no clarity to the enterprise that they were working with.
Can I get 3 glasses of water?
There was no clarity of enterprise that they were working with. It was more to release their own sense of frustration than to actually hope that their communication ripples into other disconsenting voices.
Sure thing, yeah.
So it was more as a release mechanism.
Yeah.
Which I found to be quite banal.
Benign.
Banal. Venal, banal. However you call it. So, yeah, funny you are. But have I worked with political activists? I've been in support of political activists. In fact, Bangalore is a city for political activism and the arts, because here the art and the activists are one. And you should definitely meet Suresh Kumar if you want to explore a little bit more on the cusp of where art and activism meet, because we don't have a very robust gallery culture here.
Okay.
So a lot of arts are worked in public spaces or engaged directly with the city.
Yeah.
And within that, there is a lot of activism and critiquing the state and so on and so forth. There was a gallery here, Venkatappa Art Gallery, which was, again, one of the few cultural commons in the country, in Bangalore. And it was a cheap gallery, like you could rent it for like $500, which is about £6.
Yeah.
A little more than £6 for a day.
Yeah.
You could have an exhibition.
It's a bargain.
It's a great bargain.
You could live there for that.
or just park your van outside. But people from smaller towns could come and they could have exhibitions there, you know. So it really allows for an inclusive space in the city.
Mm-hmm.
What happened was that one of the bigger art buyers and an industrialist, he, through some negotiations within the government, said he will adopt the building and convert it into a private museum. Like, redo the building and make it a really fancy space, but basically privatize it.
Yeah.
And a lot of artists in Bangalore rose up against it. This was called the VAG Forum, Venkatappa Art Gallery Forum.
VAG Forum.
Yeah. VAG Forum. And it was successful in the industrialists dropping out, and it's a milestone. It's a milestone event. VAG Forum. You should ask Suresh Kumar about the VAG Forum.
Yeah, cool.
In fact, a lot of senior artists in Bangalore were also part of.
Amesh.
Suresh. 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 Yeah, I've sent you his number.
Perfect. Yeah, you think he'll be fine talking to me?
Oh yeah. You might have to travel somewhere to meet him because he lives in the outskirts of the city. He's into farming now.
Really?
Yeah, he farms and
good plan.
Does whatever. Farming art or whatever. You should also meet this other friend of mine called Asha Chauhan.
Okay.
She also works at the cusp of art and activism.
Fantastic. I have
I'll send you her number as well.
Very nice, thank you.
Yeah,
super cool. So this is another thing that I would really be interested in, is sometimes collaboration as well with some activist artists
or
something like this. I'm not 100% sure.
Yeah.
I'll show you, I'll show you this later. I'm not quite sure what other questions kind of relate to much. I had some on my phone as well. And then, I mean, we've spoken a little bit about the background of artists. This was another kind of question I was interested in, because a lot of the time when I was researching, I'd be like, wow, they've led such an interesting life. Like, how? And then you find out they come from quite a privileged background. Maybe 90% of the artists that I research, kind of a thing. But we've kind of skimmed over that subject, and as you say, it's the same as ever, it's kind of balanced, but obviously if you have money, you have time, and then the ball's already rolling. Kind of thing.
Yeah, but the interesting thing becomes how you use your privilege, what you use your privilege for.
Yeah.
And a lot of models of success in the cultural space in India, unfortunately, seem to challenge the idea of merit-based success, because it is privilege begotten and also then begets privilege. So which is a bit of a problem.
Yeah.
But I guess that is also because there are no existing, or there are no strong ecosystems or financial models that can allow for alternate visions or alternate practices to sustain themselves. And that's the exciting bit right now, where those models are appearing, those models are creating. So
yeah,
I guess you could call it a form of activism which allows for artists to sustain themselves practicing their art practice.
Yeah, well, when we're talking about talking about the spaces you can make art, as in now we have so much virtual space, everyone has Instagram, you can be an artist for everybody to see all the time. So I guess this is breaking down a lot of the boundaries regarding class and money. Yeah, very cool. Cool. I think we might be able to leave it there, you know.
Perfect.
Yeah, I think
I'm
that's 40 minutes.
That's good.
It's going to take a while to transcribe this.
There's an easy way to transcribe.
Okay.
Friend taught me. I haven't tried it yet, but the theory exists.
Okay.
You convert your audio into video.
Okay.
Upload the video or upload the audio bit on YouTube.
Yeah.
And go for auto subtitling.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Or you can even Google transcribing through YouTube.
Yeah.
It's a free service.
Really good. Yeah.
Yeah. I used to transcribe everything myself earlier, but then this friend of mine...
Play stuff.
Yeah.
That's what I was
thinking. No, it just does everything automatically, one shot. But yeah.
Really? It just downloads it?
Yeah, you just have to download the subtitle file and access it. It just needs a bit tech.
Yeah. Fantastic. Yeah, that's a really good thing. Thank you.
No problem.
Super cool. Yeah, excellent. Thanks very much for coming to meet me.
Oh no, please. I mean, like I said, Iram is a dear friend, and more than a friend, she's
really?
Like a mentor.
That's
me.
So good. Yeah.
We've had a lot of say hi to. What?
I will pass it on to
Matea.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I will make sure that he passes it on also. Yeah. Very cool.
I hope it was helpful.
Really helpful, yeah. There was one thing I was thinking that's been on my mind for a while. I'll just tell you about this other idea that I have with art, and I'm not quite sure why or what purpose it might serve, but it was kind of to do with mold and food, and it's to do with murals as well. I kind of had this idea for a while of collecting food types. And I know from experience, if you leave a cup of coffee for a few days, it will go bright green mold, and you get different colours. So then I've had some ideas of actually painting with food, and letting the painting grow and deteriorate as it goes. This is something I'm going to be doing back at my little house in Barcelona. I've got a big surrounding wall. So I'm going
to. How long are you planning to be in India?
I've rented that house for 11 months.
You'll be here for 11 months?
I put $1.5 lakh down on this house, yeah.
Wow.
So I've got 11 months. I might nip back to England and work this festival. A few festivals. We've got Glastonbury Festival and stuff like this over the summer.
Then I'll give you a bunch of numbers. You should just get in touch with these guys.
Yeah, really cool. That would be so good. Yeah, thank you. Really nice. Well, this will be interesting in India, obviously, with the wildlife as well. I'm thinking maybe to record this, maybe stop motion of this food, painting, and just what happens to it, you know? Whether it even gets a chance to become mold, whether it just becomes food.
If you go to Goa, you should meet a friend of mine. She does a lot of work with food and plants and stuff like that.
Okay.
Nandita Kumar.
There's a lot of Kumars, huh?
Oh well, tell me about it. It's a good middle name.
It's very good, yeah. Like, how do you spell the first name, sir?
N-A-N. D-I.
D-I.
T-A.
Nandita.
T-A. D-I-T-A. Nandita.
Nandita. Kumar, Goa.
Yeah.
Working with food.
Working with food, plants, and elements.
Right.
But Suresh Kumar is working with food and growing food, actually. Vegetation.
Very cool. Nice one. What bill do we have? This is for everything, right? Oh, no.
Hot chocolate?
Oh, this is hot chocolate.
You paid.
Yeah, I did.
You played, right?
Yes, I did, yeah.
So you don't need to pay again.
Yeah, it's fine, yeah. So my head was just a bit spinning.